It has been reported that the Ford Motor Company asked Charles Jayne, author of a horoscope column of the New York Daily News, to chart the future of the new Mustang automobile. Jayne responded with this horoscope. Those born September 21, that's the date the Mustang was introduced, are particularly endowed with the basic qualities of efficiency and resourcefulness. Your moon in relation to Uranus indicates you are highly innovative, highly individualistic. Essentially, your planetary pattern is so well balanced that you should be assured of a productive and successful life. Just a public relations gimmick? Yes. But thousands of buyers took it seriously and chose to buy a Mustang because of it. Who made the horoscope come true? The stars or the buyers? It is written. This is George Vandeman. Today, It Is Written presents The Confounding of the Psychics. Jean Dixon, popular Washington seer, owes a part of her fame to a visit she claims to have had with Franklin Roosevelt. During that visit, she says, the president said to her, "One's time is short, even at its longest. How much time do you think I have to finish the work I have to do?" Well, she asked to touch his fingertips. He thus thrust forward his big hand, and she picked up his vibrations. Then she sought desperately to divert the conversation and avoid an answer. And when he insisted on a direct reply, she said reluctantly, 6 months or less. Well, careful investigation has yielded considerable doubt that the interview ever took place. However, if it did, it would not be the first time that a head of state has sought advice from a psychic. And best known of these was our beloved Abraham E. Lincoln, whose contacts with a spiritualistic medium, Nettie Maynard, are now almost legendary. Research done in the Library of Congress indicates that many of his major decisions were based on spirit guidance. World War II historians tell us that during the height of that conflict, both the Nazis and the Allies consulted astrologers to help conduct the affairs of war. On the Nazi side, writes René Norbergen, a friend of mine and a researcher in this field, astrologers guided the decisions of men such as Heinrich Himmler, Rudolf Hess, and Adolf Hitler. Britain was not far behind. When the news of the activities of the Reich's astrologers became known to London, Winston Churchill reacted by installing his own astrologer, who charted the stars and informed Churchill of the kind of decisions that he might expect from the Germans. Well, the unpredictable tides of war and the increasing battlefield losses eventually threw Hitler into a rage, we're told, and as a result, all of his astrologers were banished to concentration camps. Friend, we might be surprised or even stunned if we knew how many of the decisions of our own political leaders are based on communications with the spirit world. Unquestionably, astrology is booming in our nation's capital. It's estimated, using surveys as a guide, that 117 million Americans are currently being led by astrologers and other psychics. Our nurse newspapers publish no less than 1,200 daily astrology columns, and universities and major department stores have installed 2,350 horoscope computers across the nation. Millions on this planet of ours proudly claim to believe in both Christianity and the occult at the same time, if that were possible. It was in the pagan superstition of Mesopotamia, land of the Twin Rivers, the Euphrates and the Tigris, that astrology was born. It may have originated in that area as early as 3,000 years ago. At any rate, the city of Babylon soon became the center for the practice of this divining art. And Nebuchadnezzar, most powerful of the kings of that mighty empire, made no secret of the fact that he had an assortment of astrologers and other psychics in his court. Now, how did God feel about the rise and the popularity of these pagan superstitions? How did he feel about the various forecasting tools used by the psychics? Now, this is not hard to discover. This is not hard to discover, for he specifically prohibited their use among his people. And his words over here in Deuteronomy are a devastating condemnation of the occult. Maybe you've never read them before, but listen. Deuteronomy 18, verses 9 to 12. Here it is, Deuteronomy 18, 9 to 12. Thou shalt not learn to do after the abominations of those nations. There shall not be found among you anyone that useth divination. Now that's fortune telling. Or an enchanter, that's a magician. Or a witch, or a charmer, or a consulter with familiar spirits. That's a medium who uses a spirit guide. Or a wizard, clairvoyant, clairaudient, or psychic seer, you see. Or a necromancer, that's a medium who consults the so-called spirits of the dead. Now back to the scripture again. For all that do these things are an abomination unto the Lord. Abomination? I guess you know what that word means. And what about the prophet who claimed to speak for God when he wasn't authorized to do so? Right here in verse 20, God said, but the prophet which shall presume to speak a word in my name, which I've not commanded him to speak, or that shall speak in the name of other gods, even that prophet shall die. Now, why was God so hard on the psychics? Because a practitioner of the occult was openly giving allegiance to God's enemy. It's as simple as that. Well, now, is it that God doesn't want us to know anything about the future? No, that isn't true. That isn't true. Is he trying to keep us in the dark? No, not at all. We read from that interesting little prophet Amos, over here near the end of the Old Testament, Amos 3, verse 7. We read these words. Look, Amos, the third chapter and the seventh verse. Surely the Lord God will do nothing, see, but he revealeth his secret unto his servants, the prophets. Unto his servants, the psychics? Is that what it says? No, it says unto his servants, the prophets. Now, how does he communicate with the prophets? Back to the beginning of the Bible again, Numbers 12, verse 6. Numbers 12, verse 6, right here. Numbers 12, 6. If there be a prophet among you, I, the Lord, will make myself known unto him in a vision, and will speak unto him in a dream. Visions and dreams, not through mediums, not through spirit guides, not through crystal balls, not through horoscope charts, but visions and dreams. Yes, God wants us to know about the future, but he wants us to get it straight. He has a better way. But back to Babylon for a moment. As God saw that mighty empire, from the king on down, steeped in the occult, worshiping other gods, and turning to the psychics for counsel. I say, as God saw all of this, did he say, Babylon is wicked, Babylon is without hope, let her go? No. God loved Babylon. He wouldn't let her go without doing everything he could to win her. And he determined to go right to the top of that powerful empire. He would send a prophet right into the court of that proud and arrogant king. But this is how he worked it out. This is how he worked it out. He allowed his own people to be carried captive into Babylon. The knowledge of the true God was to be brought right into that wicked city. Now, someone may be saying, wait, do you mean that God would let calamity come to his own people just so he could do something for Babylon? No, no. God's own people, except for a small nucleus of faithful ones, had wandered away from him repeatedly. Nothing but captivity in an enemy land could wake them up. So when God works things out, he integrates everything perfectly so that no one is needlessly hurt. He always does it that way. Discipline for Israel, a witness for Babylon. Now, among these Hebrew captives were several fine, upstanding young men who were loyal to God. Almost immediately, because of their abilities, they were spotted and prepared for high positions in the king's court. And one of these young men was Daniel. But little did he dream what God had in mind for him. God was about to get the attention of the proud king, and he was about to challenge the claims of the psychics. And he began by giving a dream not to Daniel, but to the king himself, and then causing him to forget it completely. Now the king was sure of one thing, that it was something very, very important. Well, the psychics were in trouble, more trouble than they realized. Interpreting a dream was no problem. Anybody could do that. Anybody could concoct some sort of interpretation if the dream was known. But this king was being ridiculously unreasonable, at least in their estimation. He was demanding that they tell him what he had dreamed or die. Well, the psychics panicked. What if this was a trick? What if the king hadn't really forgotten the dream? What if he was just testing them? Or what if he had forgotten it, but suddenly it should come back to him? They didn't dare make up a dream. And God was giving them a little test, just one dream and what it meant. And they complain. It's too hard. Nobody asks anything like that of a psychic. But the king was unrelenting. He was determined to find out what was dreamed. And when they couldn't tell him, he condemned them all to die. Because the king didn't know the difference between a prophet and a psychic, Daniel was rounded up with the others to be executed. Well, the king didn't know the difference between a prophet and a psychic, but God proposed to show him. Daniel now fearlessly took his life in his own hands and asked to be brought in before the king. He prayed for time to pray to his God, promised to return with both the dream and his meaning. Well, king was so impressed by Daniel's quiet confidence and so anxious to know what he dreamed that he granted his request. And did God fail Daniel? No, never. In a night vision, he revealed to him what the dream king had dreamed and what it meant. Well, early in the morning, Daniel sought out the executioner. "Don't kill the psychics," he said. "Take me into the king and I'll tell him his dream." Don't kill the psychics. Think of it. Daniel was in trouble because of the miserable failure of the psychics. But his first thought was to spare them. They now owed their very lives to that young prophet. And now Daniel stood before the king. The king had been anxiously waiting for his return, you can imagine. But was it possible that this unassuming young captive could do what his trusted, aged counselors could not do? "Can you tell me the dream?" he asked excitedly. Yes, he could. But first, he wanted the king to understand that he, Daniel, had no superior wisdom of his own. Rather, it was God alone who knew the future, was about to reveal it to the king, something that no psychic counselor could do. Read the thrilling story in the second chapter of Daniel. And we pick it up with verse 31. Let me get it over here. Daniel, the second chapter, and I'll read beginning with verse 31. Can you imagine the scene? There's Daniel standing before the king. Daniel, first chapter, and here's the second chapter. Now verse 31. "You, O king, were looking, and behold, there was a single great statue. That statue, which was large and of extraordinary splendor, was standing in front of you, and its appearance was awesome." Did you see the excitement in the king's face? That was it. That was exactly what he'd seen. It all flooded back into his mind now. Yes, to the proud builder of Babylon, builder of statues and worshiper of images, God had shown the very thing most likely to attract his attention. He'd shown him a tall, magnificent statue. And now Daniel was in the process of describing it in detail, verses 32 and 33. The head of that statue was made of fine gold. Its breast and its arms of silver. Its thighs of bronze. Its legs of iron. Its feet partly of iron and partly of clay. Yes, that's exactly what he had seen. But something had happened to the statue. Would Daniel know that too? The king leaned forward, breathless, in his anticipation as Daniel went on, verses 34 and 35. You continued looking until a stone was cut out without hands, and it struck the statue on its feet of iron and clay and crushed them. Then the iron, the clay, and the bronze, and the silver, and the gold were crushed, all at the same time, became like chaff from the summer threshing floor. The wind carried them away so that not a trace of them was found. But the stone that struck the statue became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. Well, the king was absolutely stunned. Daniel hadn't missed a thing. But what did it all mean? Why was the statue made of different metals? Why wasn't it all of gold, just the way it started? And what was this stone that would crush everything before it? Well, Daniel had told him the dream, and now, without a moment's hesitation, he continued with the interpretation, I say without missing a beat. Listen to verse 38. These cryptic words, you are the head of gold. Well, the proud king liked that. It seemed very appropriate that he should be the golden head, you see. It must be, he thought, that even Daniel's God was aware of his greatness and his power. But of course, the king had been flattered before. Could it be that this was just a clever young politician standing before him, playing for royal favor? But no. Daniel's very next words settled that. He was saying what no aspiring politician would ever say. Listen, verse 39, and after you, there will arise another kingdom, inferior to you. And the king didn't like that. It was enough to spoil any monarch's proud daydreams. Daniel's God was not telling him what he wanted to be told. His kingdom was not to last forever, evidently. It was to be succeeded by another, and an inferior one at that. Is it any wonder that at a later time, Daniel's words still rankling in his mind, Nebuchadnezzar had a great statue constructed totally of gold, all of gold, the way he wanted it to be. And he had it set up there in the plain of Dura, you remember? And he commanded everybody to worship it. But Daniel's continuing, and we don't want to miss a bit of it, do we? Verse 39, listen. And another third kingdom of bronze, which will rule over all the earth. Then there will be a fourth kingdom as strong as iron. It will crush and break all these in pieces. Did you notice what God was revealing to the king? Was he telling him that there would soon be an assassination in his court? Was he telling him not to get into his carriage the next day because the stars wouldn't be right? Was he telling him about a budding romance between two of the palace servants? Oh, no, friend, no. God was revealing to that ancient king and to you and to me, not petty things around in the palace or in the news. He was revealing the mighty sweep of history in advance for us today. And did it happen? Did it happen that way? Yes, God's prophets have never been wrong. Not even once. History has followed this prophecy of Daniel as it has followed every other Bible prophecy, just like a blueprint. Still in the days of Daniel, that Babylon was conquered by Cyrus the Persian, you may remember. It was during the feast of Belshazzar. And the Medes and the Persians, represented by the two silver arms, see, dual leadership of the statue, ruled for about 200 years. Then came Alexander the Great and the Bronze Kingdom. And then the Iron Kingdom. The fourth had to be Rome, the Iron Monarchy of Rome. It couldn't be any other. Four world kingdoms. Did you see? Wouldn't you think there would be a fifth if there had been four? But no, never again would the world come under the rule of one man. Rome was to be the last of the world empires. Daniel went on to explain that the Iron Kingdom would be divided. Rome would be divided. It would be divided into 10 kingdoms, represented by the 10 toes of the statue. And those 10 kingdoms the modern nations of Europe as we know them today would never be able to get together again, said the young prophet in verse 43. And in that you saw the iron mixed with common clay, they will combine with one another in the seed of men. You see, intermarriage. But they will not adhere to one another, even as iron does not combine with pottery. What do you think of that? What do you think of that? They would not adhere to one another. The nations of Europe would not stick. How could God have said it better? They will not adhere to one another. Those are the seven words that have collided head-on with the dreams of every would-be dictator since the Caesars. They're the reason for history's uncanny repetition, as one man after another, aspiring to rule the world, has gone down in defeat. But Daniel was not through. Listen to verse 44. To verse 44. And in the days of those kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom which will never be destroyed. And that kingdom will not be left for other people. It will crush and put an end to all these kingdoms, but it will itself endure forever. In the days of those kings, the kings of modern Europe, in our day, as the next great event in Earth's history, God will intervene. The Lord Jesus Christ Himself will appear in the skies, and His kingdom will never end. That's the stone that consumed it all. Is it any wonder that the king was profoundly impressed? God had just demonstrated for him and for us, the wide and striking contrast between the trivial fortune-telling of the occult practitioners and the divine, the stately march of divine prediction. God had outlined the future as no man could ever do, and the psychics were confounded. Here was no lucky guess. Do you realize how unlucky every part of Daniel's prophecy was and is by human standards? Who could have guessed when Babylon was at the height of its glory that it was soon to fall, and that to a lesser power? Who could have guessed that four world kingdoms would not be followed by a fifth? And who could explain today why no nation of modern times, with all of our sophisticated weapons, with all of our burst of technology, has not been able to form a world empire? When Nebuchadnezzar and Cyrus and Alexander and Caesar, with their inferior weaponry, could do it? Yet one aspiring dictator after another has bumped his head against Daniel's prophecy, and it has refused to budge. Yes, the psychics of Babylon were confounded, my friend. They were confounded again in the days of Belshazzar. Again and again, down through the centuries, the psychic pretenders with those who followed them have been confounded, thrown into confusion. And the day comes, and I tremble to think how soon, when they'll be confounded again. Too late. They'll learn that the only safe place to turn for counsel is to the word of the living God. And their confusion and remorse will be beyond description. But friend, you don't have to be a part of that confusion. It does not need to be a day of remorse for you. The message of Daniel's prophecy is that Jesus is coming soon, very soon. The return of our Lord is the next big event in the inspired outline of history that God has given us, and you don't have to be unprepared. The day of darkness and confusion for the rejecters of God's grace will be a day of indescribable joy for those who've accepted that grace. Oh, friend, no words could ever picture the scene, but let your imagination and your faith take hold of it and make it the goal of your life. The day when our Lord appears in the skies. The day when heartache and tears and suffering and death are forever ended. Think of it. The day of reunion with our loved ones, with never again a goodbye. the day when with undimmed vision we look upon God's universe and know that the wonders of an unspoiled creation are forever ours, oh friend, Jesus is coming soon. And in the meantime, I urge you to let God's book be the guide and the light of your life. It'll never lead you wrong. Rather, it'll lead you to a person, and that person will lead you home. Shall we pray? Lord Jesus, deep within every human breast is a desire to not only witness this staggering, all-important event to come, but to meet it prepared. In Jesus alone is that preparation completed. Please make us clean today. Make us new. And prepare our hearts for that great day. In your priceless name we ask it. Amen.
My name is Lonnie Melashenko. Would you like to know more about the predictions of the psychics and the real source of those predictions? Would you like to know what is going on in the psychic world and why? Then you'll want the book that we have chosen as our gift for you today. It's Pastor Vandeman's book, The Impersonation Game. We'll tell you in a moment how to request your free copy. The Impersonation Game. This is a book that talks about the mysteries of death and of the future. It tells you, right from Scripture, what really happens to people when they die. What happens to the soul? Where does it go? Or does it go anywhere? All this is in this book. Ask for it by name, The Impersonation Game, so we'll know which book to send. And now here is the information you need.
You may request Pastor Vandeman's free offer by writing directly to It Is Written, Box O, Thousand Oaks, California, 91360. The offer is sent by mail free and postpaid. Our address is easy to remember. Just It Is Written, Box O, that's Box 0, Thousand Oaks, California, 91360. Please be sure to ask for the offer by name. It takes only a few moments to write, but it could mean a lifetime of satisfaction. While you're writing down the address, let me remind you to invite a friend to watch It Is Written with you next week on this station. The address again is It Is Written, Box O, Thousand Oaks, California, 91360. Please mention the offer by name and write, It Is Written, Box O, that's simply Box 0, Thousand Oaks, California, and the zip is 91360.
Goodbye, everyone, but remember, It Is Written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God.